Okay, today we'll be talking about management of community acquired pneumonia. And based on the ID Society of America and the American Thoracic Society consensus guidelines from 2007. Once upon a time, they used to have the ID Society and the ATS, they used to have different separate guidelines, but then didn't make sense because we treat the same type of patients. So they got together and there's a combined consensus. So I'll be talking about the clinical criteria for diagnosis of community acquired pneumonia, and then how to decide about the site of care, whether a patient versus inpatient, and then if the patient is going to be admitted to the hospital, the general ward versus the ICU. Thirdly, diagnostic testing. Fourth place, empiric antibiotic treatment. Fifth, risk factors for special pathogen. That constitutes just 2 to 3% of the total number of community acquired pneumonia. Six, timing of antibiotic treatment. Seventh, management of patients who fail to respond. Patients with community acquired pneumonia fail to respond. Eighth, preventive measures. I got plenty of handouts for everybody, so the new guys coming can pick it up from the back. These are the criteria we usually follow. I mean, in general, you always need to have an infiltrate. I mean, the criteria for diagnosis of community acquired pneumonia. Hospital acquired pneumonia is a different ball game. So you always need to have an infiltrate on the chest X-ray, and without an infiltrate, you cannot diagnose pneumonia. Sometimes we cannot see it on the chest X-ray, and we get a CAT scan, and we see it on the CAT scan. And two or more of the following criteria: cough can be productive or non-productive. Pleuritic chest pain is, in other words, chest pain that increases with deep inspiration or cough. Then dyspnea. Then on the physical exam, tachypnea, respiratory rate faster than 20 per minute. Fever, temperature greater than 38 centigrade, which is about 100 Fahrenheit. Crackles or bronchial breathing on physical exam when doing expiration, you hear the that's the bronchial breathing. And then leukocytosis or leukopenia with vandemia. How do we decide the site of care, the triage? How do we do the triage of these patients? Well, to decide whether the patient needs to be admitted or sent home, we use we have several severity of illness scores. The most simple ones, the one I use myself is CURB 65. It's British. It's everything British, kind of short. C for confusion, B for BUN greater than 20, R for respiratory rate greater than 30, so tachypnea, B for blood pressure less than 90, over 60, and 65 for age 65 or older. Each item is it's 1 point. The score is equals one, it's okay for outpatient therapy. If it's greater than one, hospitalized. So that's the CURB 65. Then PSI, that's the American severity of illness score. PSI stands for pneumonia severity index. It's kind of cumbersome, you need a calculator. It's fine. I mean, you have two options. Then the Australians came up with a smart COP. I'll show you the how to do it. It's kind of nice. It's as far as complication is in between the most simple one and the most complicated one, somewhere in between. And then regarding ICU admission, we use the ATS score. And if the patient has one out of two major criteria, or three or even four minor criteria, then indication for ICU admission. There are hands out in the back row there. And that's probably the best model to predict a severe committee acquired pneumonia. I'll show you in a minute. So this is the smart cop from Australia. Systolic blood pressure less than 60. That's SM multilobar chest X-ray involvement. By the way, hypotension is 2 points. Multilobar chest X-ray involvement 1 point. A for albumin less than 3.5, 1 point. R for respiratory rate, which needs to be H adjusted, 1 point if the patient is tachymic. T for tachycardia greater equal or greater than 125. 1 point. C for confusion, 1 point. O for oxygen desaturation, it's 2 points. And also they make a distinction, younger than 50 and greater than 50. And then P for arterial pH, if it's, patient is acidotic, less than 735, then 2 points. So in case you're interested, that was published a couple of years ago in Clinical Infectious Diseases, CID journal. Okay, and these are the, as I mentioned before, these are the ATS criteria for severe community acquired pneumonia. So that's, when a patient meets this criteria, you can send the patient to the, patient needs to go to the ICU. As I said before, either one of the two major criteria at the bottom. So it's very simple to remember. Major criteria, the patient is respiratory failure, need for invasive mechanical ventilation, needs to go to the ICU. Or patient septic shock with need for pressors, needs to go to the ICU. So either one or the other. So one major criteria, or three or even four is better, according to a recent study published last year from University of Utah. They validated this score, and they said for assessing severe community acquired pneumonia is probably the best score. But they said better use four than rather than three minor criteria. Again, you see most of the criteria keep on repeating themselves. So respiratory rate greater than 30, tachypnea, the PAFI, the PO2 FiO2 ratio less than 250, multilobar infiltration chest X-ray, or CAT scan, confusion, uremia, leukopenia, thrombocytopenia, hypothermia, hypotension, requiring aggressive fluid resuscitation, not shock yet. That's how you decide. So myself personally, I just use the CURB 65. And then because I usually work in the ICU, I use this ATS criteria. They're pretty good and very simple. And most of the time, the patient meets one of the two major criteria. But if it doesn't meet the major criteria, they just look for the minor criteria. As far as diagnostic testing, for the guys who are late, I'm just following the 2007 ATS guidelines. Diagnostic testing for etiology in patient admitted to the hospital. These for the ones that need to be admitted. For the outpatients, the ones who can be treated at home, this is optional. So you have to make the distinction. So if you're working with outpatients, you don't need all these tests. So, you can do it. You can order them, but it's optional. But the ones admitted to the hospital, you have to consider all these tests. So, get blood cultures before you start antibiotics, and also be aware of the false blood culture, sometimes we get gram-positive coxine clusters, turn out to be staph epi because they didn't clean up the skin well. Also, they have to be taken half an hour apart or so. Sometimes, you know, they try to expedite, so just take them two samples at the same time. That's not good. Second place, also before antibiotics started, get a sputum, a good sputum for a gram staining culture. If the patient is intubated, you know, from day one, then get endotracheal secretions for gram staining culture also. Mycobacteria staining culture, you know, the VA, they have an obsession with the mycobacteria staining and culture, but used to be for everybody with community acquired pneumonia, but now we use this indication. So if the patient meets one of these indications, then you do it, otherwise no need to do it. So number one, night sweats. Another indication is cough for more than 2 weeks. Another one is history of weight loss, significant weight loss. 4, hemoptysis. 5, chest x-ray shows upper lobe infiltrate or infiltrate with cavitation. 6, the patient is homeless or comes from prison, incarcerated, in other words. 7, prior exposure to TB, history of prior exposure to TB or history of positive PPD. And 8, patient is known to have HIV. Legionella culture in areas where Legionella is endemic or recent travel. So, you know, involving going to hotels, cruise ship. For instance, in my area, Mediterranean, Southern Europe and the Mediterranean, there's a lot of Legionella. So that's one area, but where you have to be aware. And as I said, in the cruise ship, sometimes the water is contaminated with Legionella. They can get it there. So another thing is either sputum or the endotracheal aspirate turn out to be have negative gram and culture for MRSA or for Pseudomonas. You can rule them out because MRSA and Pseudomonas are easy to grow. So the sputum or the endotracheal aspirate doesn't grow, kind of rules it out. That's why, you know, the antibiotic team, the pharmacist, they came in 2-3 days later, said, can we discontinue vancomycin because the patient, the culture is negative for MRSA? And usually we say yes. Same thing applies to Pseudomonas, in case the patient is taking, is getting coverage for Pseudomonas. Then the urinary antigens for Legionella and Strep pneumo, we order on everybody, that's routine. And then remember, this is you know, the Ohio Valley, it's a place where there's a lot of histoplasmosis, so it's endemic, histo is endemic in the Ohio Valley. So if you suspect that the patient can have acute histoplasmosis, then you can order urine antigen. Only there's suspicion for that. Don't order on everybody. It's a send out, and you have to justify it. Then if a patient is immunocompromised, like a patient with, you know, post-transplant or being treated for, you know, hematological malignancy or HIV, etc., comes with pneumonia from home, you ask the pulmonary people to do a bronchoscopy with the BAL, but just for the immunocompromised patients. In general, we don't do bronchoscopies. It's not indicated to do bronchoscopies patients who come with community acquired pneumonia, except in this particular group of patients. And then number 5, pleural fluid gram staining culture. So if the patient has a pleural effusion that meets this criteria, greater than 5 centimeter height on the lateral upright chest x-ray, or greater than 3 centimeters height on the CAT scan, then it's indication to tap. Used to be the lateral of the cube more than 10 millimeters think that was it. But nobody does the lateral decubitus anymore, so you order lateral decubitus, you may be waiting for next day. Whereas everybody, I mean, you know, it's easy to get a chest X-ray, but it has to be upright, or a lot of patients get a CAT scan. And then nasopharyngeal specimen, in, you know, during the flu season, then nasopharyngeal swab for PCR if H1N1 flu is suspected, or nasal wash if influenza B is suspected. And I believe Dr. Ramirez has a grant to study the incidence of viral pneumonia in patients with chlamydia acquired pneumonia. Then number seven, blood procalcitonin. Well, this is repetitive. The main roles for the procalcitonin are A, for the diagnosis, to distinguish bacteria from viral community acquired pneumonia, so be elevated in bacterial pneumonia. It shouldn't be elevated in viral pneumonia. B, as a guide to antibiotic therapy. C, for prognosis purposes. If the procalcitonin shows persistent high levels on serial measurements, that means worse prognosis, worse outcome. Whereas if, you know, it might be elevated initially and then starts trending down, that's a good sign. Stays persistently high, that's a bad sign. So it's available. You can order it. That's from the Swiss study. I don't know if it's in the papers I gave you or not, but that's Swiss study that was published last year in JAMA. And that's the algorithm they follow. So if it's low, the procalcitonin less than 0.1 micrograms per liter, then the bacterial etiology is very unlikely. So antibiotics, no. 2 times, no. 0.1 to 0.25, bacterial etiology is unlikely. No antibiotics. Between 0.25 and 0.5, bacterial etiology likely, so antibiotics, yes. And greater than 0.5, bacterial etiology, very likely, so antibiotics, yes. So that's how we use it. Then number eight, there's some new microbiology techniques. For instance, even recent papers on detection of bacteremia, fungemia by multiplex PCR tests. So these are PCR that check the blood for different pathogens. And it, you know, for instance, it detects MRSA, but I think it misses enterococci, for instance. So it kind of complements the blood culture. So you kind of just decide on a negative multiplex PCR test, the patient doesn't have a bacteremia, but you combine this with the results of the multiplex PCR with the result from the blood culture, because sometimes the PCR is positive and the blood culture are negative, and as I said, vice versa. Luis from the United States published in Critical Care Medicine 2008, and then Yanagihara is from Japan, just published a paper in Critical Care. That's electronic journal. And then, very interesting, and that's a landmark study, I think. You'll be familiar with this study. You'll hear a lot about this study, which is the rapid molecular detection of MTB and rifampin resistance by expert MTB/rifampin test. That's based on PCR. And it was in the New England last week. The results are available in 1 hour and 45 minutes. So the patient is waiting there. While he's waiting, he gets, you know, the results come back in less than 2 hours. And that's Boehm, New England. I don't know the pronunciation, but sounds like La Boehm by Puccini. New England this September. So, and that's great because especially in the developing world, third world, whatever you call it, you know, there's a lot of TB. We don't have much TB in the United States, but TB is, I think it's one out of four people in the world carries the TB bacilli. And that can diagnose TB very quickly, as well as whether the bacilli is resistant to rifampin or not. And so the patient can be treated early in the course of the disease, so then doesn't spread the disease. So that will cut back on a lot of transmission of the TB infection. So it's got, I mean, it'll be very important because the, you know, the TB, amino acid fast smear and culture, I mean, they've been around for over 100 years. Nothing has changed. Now these are the new tests. So if you have a minute, read the paper. It's very important. For the guys who just came in, there's some handouts in the back. Empirical therapy, and that's in the handout. If the patient is considered that he can be treated as outpatient, most common pathogens, as far as typical bacteria, Strep pneumoniae and H flu. As far as atypicals, mycoplasma pneumonia, chlamydia pneumonia, and respiratory viruses. So that's what you usually have to cover the patient for. If the patient is, the outpatient is a healthy person, no risk factors for drug-resistant Strep pneumo, then the macrolide is okay. Doxycycline is an alternative. If the outpatient has comorbidities, CPD, congestive heart failure, renal failure, etc., or the patient has been using antibiotics previously, then respiratory quinolone like moxifloxacin or levofloxacin, or a beta-lactam, usually oral, plus macrolide. The oral macro beta-lactams, you can use amoxiclavulanic, or you can use cefuroxime, both are oral, or 1 gram a day of ceftriaxone IM. If we're dealing with treating inpatients, but no ICU on the floor, the most common pathogens to consider typical are Strep pneumo, H flu, oral anaerobes, especially to be considered patients at risk for aspiration, like gum disease, plus decreased level of consciousness, like patient with a seizure, has seizures, or alcohol, has been drinking, or dysphagia. Then you have to call for anaerobes. And then atypical microorganisms, Legionella, C. pneumonia, mycoplasma pneumonia, and respiratory viruses. And for these patients on the floor, respiratory quinolone alone, or beta-lactam plus macrolide. If the patient is at risk for aspiration, then you can add metronidazole or Clindam. Now it's not the tradition here in Louisville, but this is the from the guidelines. So people think metronidazole is just from below the diaphragm and clean the above the diaphragm, but you can use it and it's acceptable. But remember, moxi or ampicillobactam also have anaerobic activity. And then inpatient, the patient is sick, comes to the ICU, most common pathogens, the typical Strep pneumo, H flu, and then you have to consider here also enteric bacilli, you know, like E. coli, Klebsiella, and so on, and also as well as Pseudomonas, and then Staph aureus, you know, always in the ICU, Legionella also, because patients with Legionella are usually very sick. So when they make it into the ICU, always consider strep pneumo Legionella, always cover for both. So for all ICU patients, cover both, strep pneumo Legionella. And use double anti-pneumo antibiotic therapy. So that's, these are the two options, beta-lactam plus macrolide. Or that's, we prefer this one because there's a lot of strep pneumos that are resistant to macrolide. So beta-lactam plus respiratory quinolone. And most patients get, you know, a third generation cephalosporin like ceftriaxone or ceftriaxone, plus respiratory quinolone, moxi or levo. And since levo has anti-pseudomonal activity, we usually save it for the hospital acquired pneumonias. But remember, the patient might also have pseudomonas or staph aureus. So suspect pseudomonas if the patient has risk factor for pseudomonas. These are the main ones, structural lung disease, like bronchiectasis, history of bronchiectasis. Oh, it's been reported on the previous CAT scans. Two, severe COPD, and the main reason because they get steroids for exacerbations, for frequent exacerbations, and then the steroids make them more susceptible to pseudomonas. Or prior antibiotic use, and patients are always taking antibiotics, they keep on coming back, and more antibiotics, and finally they get the pseudomonas, or alcohol abuse. And then for these, the recommendations are anti-pneumococcal, anti-pseudomonal beta-lactam, plus anti-pseudomonal quinolone. Or the same beta-lactam plus an aminoglycoside plus a macrolide, because beta-lactam plus aminoglycoside doesn't cover the Legionella. So you have to cover Legionella with a macrolide or anti-pneumococcal quinolone. Patient is allergic to beta-lactamic antibiotic, then aztreonam. If you suspect community-acquired MRSA, you have to suspect it when you see gram-positive cocci in the tracheal aspirate. Or the patient has risk factors for community-acquired MRSA, including end-stage renal disease, patient comes from the hemodialysis unit, or is a drug user, or the patient just had the flu, recovering from the flu, so during the flu epidemic. So typically, after the flu, patients might get strep pneumo, or they might get staph aureus, or prior quinolone treatment. For some reason, the quinolones favor later on superinfection with MRSA. And also suspect MRSA if the chest X-ray shows necrotizing pneumonia, pneumonia with cavitation. So then you add vancomycin and you do that. We do that often when a patient comes from the community with these risk factors. Plus, minus, clean there. And that's also in the guidelines. The reason being that the community MRSA, community acquired MRSA, might be the one that produces the toxin that causes cavitation, the Ponton Valentine toxin. And if you add clean, that kind of blocks the toxin. All anisolate, either vancomycin or anisolate, can use the one. Okay, and this is kind of interesting, especially for real life and also for the exams. These are also from the guidelines, epidemiology conditions and all risk factors related to specific pathogens in community-acquired pneumonia. You know about the alcoholism that makes them more susceptible to strep pneumo, the anaerobes because they aspirate when they're under the effect of the alcohol, Klebsiella pneumonia, TB, etc. CPD, they more susceptible to H flu, Pseudomonas when they've been taking steroids, Legionella, strep pneumo, Moraxella, Chlamydia. Nice, I got they changed the name a little bit, chlamydophila pneumonia, aspiration, gram-negative enteric pathogens, as well as oral anaerobes, long abscess, community acquired MRSA, anaerobes from the mouth, fungal pneumonia, TB, a typical mycobacteria. I didn't put it in the handout, but you can easily access the references there for this table. It's got a lot of information. As I said, these are the ones that constitute just 3 or 4% of the total number of community-acquired pneumonia. Exposure to bat or bird droppings, well, histoplasma capsulata, they've been cleaning the rooster house or whatever, and they've been in the caves, spelunking, exposure to bats and so on, or demolishing old houses and so on. So consider history in the Ohio Valley. Exposure to birds, then psittacosis, but if chickens, then avian flu. Exposure to rabbits, tularemia. You know, they go hunting and then they skin the rabbit and they can get tularemia. And it occurs here in Kentucky. Exposure to farm animals or parturient cat having kittens, Q fever. HIV infection early on, strep pneumo, H flu, and MTB. So usually the, you know, early HIV patients, you treat as a regular patient, but always check for TB, as we said before. Now, when it's late, when the CD4 is very low, then to the above pathogens, you have to add the PCP, and then, of course, the fungal infections, atypical mycobacteria, TB and atypical mycobacteria, and TB already mentioned above. So atypical mycobacteria, Pseudomonas, H flu. These are the patients that, you know, they need a BL or admission. Otherwise, you cannot, if you want to cover for all this, you need like 5 or 6 drugs and tremendous toxicity. As I mentioned before, hotel or cruise ship stay previous 2 weeks, Legionella. Travel to or residence in southwestern United States, Arizona and so on. Coccidia, it's species. You are in the desert there enjoying the nice weather in the winter time. They're looking at the cactuses and the jackrabbits there and a little bit of wind, and there you are. You get the dust and you get cocci. Hunter virus, if you go into the barns where the mice are. And that can be very serious. It presents like ARDS. Or travel to or reside in Southeast and East Asia. Pseudomyeloidosis. There are cases like this during the Vietnam War. I haven't seen any in the past few years I've been here. Avian flu, SARS. And then, as I mentioned before, when flu is active in the community, then you have to, in addition to flu causing pneumonia, you have to consider following the viral pneumonia or viral infection, strep pneumo and staph aureus, as well as H flu. So this spike of staph aureus pneumonia following the flu, or almost concomitant with the flu. Cough 12 weeks with a hoop or post-tussive vomiting. So it's a protracted cough. They do this inspiratory hoop after the cough, and then they can also vomit. You know, that's the triad. And the cough look 12 weeks. It can be long. That's why the Chinese call it the disease of the 100 days, because it can last 100 days or so. And of course, people are not well immunized against the whooping cough, against the pertussis. So you see it every now and then. We had a patient at the VA that was driving me bonkers because the lady wanted to diagnose the patient coughing, you know, and so we did bronchoscopy, and bronchoscopy was negative, and she says, but he's still coughing. I said, you're telling me that bronchoscopy is normal? I said, yeah, bronchoscopy, and there's nothing there. I mean, and then all of a sudden, I saw the light, and I said, hey, man, let's check him for pertussis, and he had a whooping cough, but that was here in Louisville. I'm not talking about a different place. So be aware of that. And sometimes the adults get it from the kids. Patient with, we mentioned that structural lung disease, bronchiectasis, pseudomonas, bronchiectasis in the borehole area, sepacia. In the old days, years ago, used to be called pseudomonas sepacia. Now they changed the name, staph aureus. So these are patients predisposed to this type of infections, being CF or different type of patient. And then injection drug use, IV junkies, IV drug users, staph aureus, anaerobes because they're groggy and they aspirate, MTB, strepnemo, endobronchial obstruction, what do you call it, post-obstructive pneumonia, usually it's tumor blocking their way. So anaerobes, strepnemo, H flu, staph aureus. And then in the context of bioterrorism, like it happened a few years ago, you have anthrax, these crazy nuts putting anthrax in the post office in Washington, etc. Yersinia pestis plague, or tularemia. So you don't get it just from the rabies. You also get it from this bioterrorism situations. Okay, the timing of the IBGs, the timing of the antibiotics, time to first antibiotic dose at the VA thing is within the first 1 or 2 hours, the ER is supposed to give the first dose, but I get to say, to be honest, the guidelines, they don't have a rigid time window for the first dose. They just say first dose in the ER, to be given in the ER. Presumably, the patient doesn't spend 24 hours in the ER. So they diagnose the pneumonia, they start the antibiotics, send the patient to the floor. Most of the patients at the VA, at least most of the patients with pneumonia get admitted because they are not in very good health. And then time to switch from IV to oral. You'll see the pharmacist coming around and telling you, don't you think the patient can be switched to oral? Well, these are the criteria. We use, and Dr. Ramirez has published extensively on this topic, patient is clinically improving, the cough is improving, dyspnea improving, the need for O2, supplemental O2 is less, hemodynamic is stable, afebrile, the white count is decreasing. This I don't think that is in the Swiss criteria here at the University of Louisville. I just added because that's something we always follow. And able to take PO, of course, if the patient's throwing up, you're going to give him oral antibiotics. And have normal GI function. Patient has an ileus, you're not going to give antibiotics orally. And then duration depends on the type of pneumonia. Strepnemo with no bacteremia, you continue antibiotics until the patient becomes afebrile, then 3 more days, and that's probably enough. And that's going to be, 6, 7, 8 days, something like this. If the patient's bacteremic, 10 to 14 days is reasonable. Legionella, 10 to 21 days. Necrotizing pneumonia, secondary to pseudomonas, staph aureus, anaerobes, these are the main causes of necrotizing pneumonia. And of course, TB is another one that is not here. At least 2 weeks, and sometimes 3 weeks. You have to follow the patient. There's no set rule for this. These are the... From the guidelines, from the ATS guidelines, is that the criteria for clinical stability. More or less what I mentioned when I said you can switch. Patients becoming afebrile, I mean the temperature is down. He shouldn't be having a hemodynamic compromise. The oxygenation should be okay. And can take PO and is mentally okay too. Okay, what do you do when the patient fails to respond. Well, the cost is you have to, I make it simple, you read the consensus, you can spend the whole Sunday reading the consensus, let me tell you, there's a lot of pages there. I just gave you the bridge version with a handout. The causes you can be boils down to one, resistant organism or nosocomial superinfection. So the microorganism you're treating is resistant to the antibiotics the patient is getting. Two, metastatic infection like parapneumonic effusion / empyema, or endocarditis or meningitis or arthritis. And that happens, especially in alcoholics. We have pneumonia. Sometimes they can get meningitis, especially with extreme pneumonia. With staph aureus, you see patient with pneumonia, and then they also get arthritis or stromatitis of the spine or endocarditis, you know. So that might be a reason. Usually they have manifestations to suspect that. Three, it might be the case that the patient doesn't have infection. So it would be BOOP. BOOP, by the way, can follow the pneumonia, but BOOP can be due to other causes, like medication. For instance, amiodarone can cause BOOP, or collagen vascular disease, or idiopathic BOOP, etc. Or the patient might have a PE with an infarction, for instance, or might have a cardiac problem, like the patient might have a MI with CHF. Or the patient has vasculitis, like, you know, like a Wegener's, for instance. Or the patient might be just having drug fever, he's having fever from the antibiotics he's getting. So the management, very succinctly here, reevaluate history for risk factors for the specific pathogens I mentioned before. The long list I gave you just a few minutes ago. Then do pan cultures. There's a warning here. If the cultures grow a resistant organism, you have to differentiate colonization versus superinfection. Is the patient just colonized because he's been in the hospital for several days, or that's a superinfection that follows the committee acquire? So sometimes you get the, you know, let's culture the sputum again, and then you get the Pseudomonas. Is the Pseudomonas or minus A? Are they causing the infection or just colonizing the respiratory tract? That's a big question. The patient is getting better, everything is getting better, you get the Pseudomonas from the sputum, you might disregard. Consider fungal studies, including histourinary antigen, if you suspect that it could be histoplasmosis. And then, as I said before, now it's routine. On admission, everybody gets Legionella and pneumococcal antigen, but sometimes the resident doctor forgets, and so you order it. And then if you can discontinue beta-lactam because other things are being negative, you consider drug fever and then stop the beta-lactam. You can do also a chest CT for looking for PE or pleural effusion. Sometimes the pleural effusion, especially the very sick patients in the ICU, you don't see the pleural effusions very well, but you do a CAT scan. If you just look for pleural effusion, you don't need contrast. Just CAT scan of the chest without contrast takes 10 minutes. Or long abscess, also the CT is much better. Or you might see a tumor obstructing their way, and that's why the pneumonia is not getting better. And then if everything else fails, you ask for bronchoscopy. That patient is not getting better, fails to respond, consult to pulmonary for a bronch with a BAL and possible transbronchial biopsies. And prevention of community-acquired pneumonia. Well, the patient is there, you just give the patient pneumococcal vaccine. And I usually try to do it when the patient's in the ICU, because they're on the floor sometimes, you know, the message gets lost. But if the ICU doesn't do it, the people on the floor team can do it. Same thing for the influenza vaccine. And also consider the pertussis vaccine, that is tetanus, diphtheria, and pertussis. Then smoking cessation is very important because, smokers, they get more infections. So usually the trend now is to use combination of various first-line treatments. That may boost the rates of smoking abstinence over single agent. So just don't just give up. At least that's what I do, and that's what I learned from Dr. Hurst. Dr. Hurt, the specialist in nicotine addiction in Mayo Clinic that gave grand rounds here just a few years ago. They throw everything to the patient. So usually what we do at the VA is not only for these patients, but in general, COPD patient, et cetera, with the oxygen still smoking, it's pitiful. So the patch, bupropion, SR, provided they haven't had seizures. And then lozenges, we're trying to get the lozenge, nicotine lozenge available. The VA is not available yet, but you tell the patient, buy it over the counter. The $30, they give them like three tubes of lozenges. And also, this is for public health. Higher tobacco taxes and a smoke-free workplace are two effective public health policies. This is beyond us. I mean, this is for the politicians and the policymakers, et cetera, to do it, but it makes a tremendous difference. You raise the taxes, and some people don't take up smoking, for instance, young kids. And a smoke-free workplace used to be cool to smoke. Now you see them outside smoking in these shacks, for smokers who look like almost like lepers or something like this. So it's not cool anymore, not to smoke. So this makes a tremendous difference. Actually, there's a paper in circulation a few months ago, since they started implementing this policy for smoke-free workplace, the incidence of heart attacks decreased tremendously. I don't remember what state was it, but probably California. So there's a sunset here, sunset. And that's the second part, and that will take me only 10 minutes or shorter. This is the saying that the sun should never set on a paraneumonic effusion. So, but the exception to the rule is the thoracentesis is not indicated for small effusions, less than 5 centimeters height on the lateral right chest X-ray, already mentioned that, or less than 3 centimeters height on CT chest. How do I know that it's less than 3 centimeters? Because we did a study with our friends from IDE and also Dr. Moffett, a hospitalist, and we review a lot of patients with pneumonia and paraneumonic effusion. There's correlation between these two measurements. So the lateral film, the circulation with the chest CT. So these small effusions don't need to tap unless they become big. In the handout, there is the original classification of paraneumonic effusions by Dr. Light, Richard Light from Vanderbilt. Later on, the group of experts got together under the auspices of the American College of Chest Physicians, 2000, 10 years ago, and they came up with this consensus. It's the same, similar to the Dr. Light's, but more refined. So they have three parameters they go by. They have the pleural anatomy, they have the pleural fluid bacteriology, and chemistry. So it's A, B, and C. A for anatomy, B for bacteriology, and C for chemistry. As far as the anatomy, if it's a small effusion like we've been talking about, see, they use less than 10 millimeters lateral decubit. Nobody does lateral decubit. I mean, so that's why we use the numbers I just gave you. So if it's a small effusion, and then and B is unknown because you don't tap, and also C is unknown because you don't tap. You have the pH. Well, this is going to be category one. So the risk of a poor outcome is very low. No, don't drain. Back to the anatomy, if it's A1 is means small to moderate. In other words, it's more than 10, I mean, it's more than the numbers I gave you before, or but less than half hemithorax, occupies less than half hemithorax, and it's free flowing. Free flowing means it's not loculated. And the culture is negative because you tap these ones, as we mentioned before. And the pH is 7.20 or greater, that's category 2. The risk of poor outcome is low, so no need to drain. But if you have, going back to the anatomy, if you have a large free-flowing fusion occupying more than half the hemithorax, or the fusion is loculated, or you see thickening of the parietal pleura, although Dr. Richard Light doesn't believe on the thickened parietal pleura, but it's in the consensus. Or the bacteriology is positive for culture, I mean the pleural fluid culture, or the Gram stain is positive, something grows there, or something shows on the Gram stain. Or the pleural pH is less than 7.20. You have to have a blood gas syringe ready there and ice ready to take it down to the lab, to the ABG lab. Well, that would be one of these three would constitute, would be under category 3, and that would be moderate risk of poor outcome, and yes, you have to drain the fluid. Or the other, the worst case scenario is when you tap the patient and it's pus, it looks like pus. Then the risk of a poor outcome is very high, it's category 4. Then you drain. You drain, I mean, you can, you know, some, especially the, you know, category 3, repeated thoracentesis versus chest tube versus VATS. In the case of pus, it's going to be a chest tube. Probably VATS and sometimes open thoracotomy with you know, getting all the pus out and the decortication of the lung and so on. If you are in the sticks and you don't have a blood gas machine, then you can do use sugar instead of pH. Sugar, I think, is less than 40 or less than I think it's less than 40 or maybe 60, they say here. I usually go by 40, but usually correlates with the pH, because the bacterial infection consuming the sugar and producing lactate. So you're going to, in this significant infection of the pleural space, you're going to find low sugar, and of course the lactate goes up, so the pH becomes acidotic. So ubi pus, ibi vacua, that's a Latin, means where there is pus. Where there is pus, there you evacuate. So remember that, it's from the old days. And this, do you, are you able to translate this? Nicole, Ars longa? No. That's the first aphorism of Hippocrates. Yeah, the art is long, the life is brief. Okay, the opportunity is fleeting, or is precipitous, means passes very fast. Experimentum precolosum means experiments dangerous, and judgment is difficult. You don't study Latin anymore, do you? And that's it. As I said, it's not in the handout, but you can access to it. Any questions? I'll be glad. Well, we're waiting for Dr. Bobby.